is the day. I've allowed the excitement to build over the weekend, playing the scene over and over in my mind. Images of his face swirled and surfaced clearly so that I could see the detail, the emotion, the expression that will flash across his face at precisely that moment. That's what gives me the greatest pleasure. That's what I need. Thinking about it sends a thrill through my veins, flushing my cheeks. I breathe in deeply, enjoying the tingling sensation in my fingers. I've rehearsed the final act in my mind, played it out in my dreams so that I feel primed, rehearsed, ready. I consider myself, after all these years, to be accomplished, an artist. Yesterday, I popped out to purchase the usual celebratory bottle of Asti, and on impulse purchased some new supplies. I couldn't help myself, wandering the aisles, fingering the selection, impressed at the range on offer. I spent more than I should have, but enjoyed the sense of indulgence. And this morning, I could barely contain myself. I drew back the curtains wide, allowing the wintry morning sun to flood into the room, and smiled luxuriously, enjoying the anticipation building within. My nerve endings felt hot and sensitive. I hummed as I selected my outfit, something comfortable, but that would allow ease of movement. Flat shoes, I thought, would be best. And because it's a special day, a touch of makeup and a spray of perfume applied with a flourish. At school, I briefly consult my timetable, eye the blank space that confirms my free lesson, and smile quietly to myself. I check my watch. Half an hour to go. My students are bent silently over their desks, pens scribbling across the pages. I move among them, monitoring their progress, a word of praise here, a correction of grammar there. They have no idea. No idea of what lies beneath the surface, my true self. The absolute antithesis of the boring, middle-aged, slightly frumpy persona that I extend. My good mood is observed by them, commented on. Is it my birthday? Someone dares to ask. I check my watch again. 15 minutes. My stomach lurches and I realize I'm nervous now. I can't sit still, so continue to move around the room. And foolishly, by way of a distraction, randomly select a student and inquire as to whether she had a pleasant weekend. Of course it takes the student by surprise. She stares at me, mouth agape, before trying to formulate a response. Silent, shocked expressions are exchanged amongst the students. I'm furious at myself for this lack of control, and I remonstrate internally. What am I thinking? Normality at all costs. The bell announces end of class. And I dismiss the students. I'm slightly breathless now as I think of him. Outside, I raise my face to the wind, breathing in the fresh, crisp November air, enjoying the breeze, but aware of the risk I am taking and of the dangers that could present themselves at any moment, some unforeseen occurrence to impede my progress. I maintain an outwardly calm, unhurried appearance as I cross the school to the old hut. I almost relish an encounter, something unexpected, to be given an opportunity to draw on my skills as a professional and to enhance the thrill and heighten the tension. The abandoned hut is almost obscured now by overgrown foliage, an ideal location for secret clandestine activities. Inside, I stop to compose myself for a moment. I listen for him in the gloom, but hear nothing. Carefully, I pick my way across the remnant of carpet tiles, and avoiding the pools of water and the scattering of rodent droppings, to reach the little room at the very back of the hut and the double-doored cupboard within. I unlock the padlock. I draw the chain from the handles and fling the doors wide. And there he is. When the doors open, allowing light into the darkness, he moves and turns his head in my direction. Upon recognition, his eyes widen in relief, and he starts to make inaudible noises from his gag. I watch him for a few seconds with enormous pleasure, because the look on his face tells me that he thinks I am his rescue. And so the final act can begin. And so I bend and look him in the eye and tell him, "You need to be punished." The boy's eyes widen in shock at the realization that I'm not here to help him. Fear replaces relief, and he starts to grunt and shake his head from side to side, and I watch carefully, noting the detail. The eyes are wild and wet, and the nostrils flare and bubble. I have made the right choice in selecting this one. He is the most deserving. I have watched and waited patiently, taking note of each incident and every assault. I've listened to that filthy mouth spew forth expletives, disrespect, and rudeness. I have watched as he spat at, picked on, and thumped the weak. And for the past year, I have painstakingly catalogued the evidence and judged him guilty. It was the assault on my friend that clinched it. Seeing Deborah like that in the staff room, sitting hunched in the corner, sobbing quietly into a tissue and being consoled by a colleague. She'd been spat at, apparently, and called a stupid fucking bitch by a year 9 boy. This boy, now bound and gagged before me, and ready for his comeuppance. And so I stoop to my bag of supplies, and I select the roll of cling film. Swiftly, I wrap several layers around his whole head, and watch as he thrashes and writhes and becomes still. And finally, I remove his tie for my collection.